Hello everyone. My name is Emma and this is Learn from the Past, a channel where I geek out about cool history stuff and you hopefully learn some cool history stuff. Let's get started. Today, we're going to be talking about the Lavender Scare, the anti-gay crusade within the Red Scare. So to start out with, let's do a very, very brief overview of the Red Scare. So the US had long been worried about communism, seeing it as a threat to their capitalist society. These fears escalated with the globalization brought on by World War II. During the war, the US had fought on the same side as the Soviet Union, but they weren't allies in the genial sense of the word. It was more of a the enemy of my enemy is my friend type situation. When the war ended, the US turned its attention toward fighting the spread of communism, which was the dominant political force in the Soviet Union, as well as other previously allied countries, such as China. This led to a period of persecution and paranoia known as the Red Scare, in which federal employees were interrogated and fired for suspected communist leanings. This could mean passing state secrets to communist countries, the circulation of communist propaganda, or it could mean having once spoken to someone suspected of communist leanings. Within the Red Scare, there was a smaller, more subversive movement known as the Lavender Scare. Federal employees at all levels were interrogated for suspected homosexuality, and those deemed to be gay were fired out of the fear that foreign agents, specifically communists, could exploit the employees' sexuality to blackmail state secrets out of them. It is this smaller movement, the Lavender Scare, that we're going to discuss today. On February 9th, 1950, shortly after the end of World War II, Senator Joe McCarthy gave a speech on the Senate floor that quickly became infamous. In his speech, McCarthy alleged that communist spies had infiltrated all levels of US government and were selling state secrets to the country's enemies. This speech launched what became known as the Red Scare. Then, Undersecretary of State John Purifoy followed McCarthy's statement about communists in the federal government with a statement indicating that many of the people who had been fired were also gay. This sparked a national hysteria about gay people and created a link between communism and homosexuality in the minds of the American public. The Purifoy revelation that there were 91 gay people dismissed from the State Department set in motion a flurry of fear-mongering and finger-pointing that became known as the Lavender Scare. The list of supposed security risks in the State Department presented by McCarthy on the floor of the Senate chamber was known as the Lee List, as it had been compiled by Senator Robert E. Lee in 1947. The Lee List continued to circulate even after those on it had been dismissed or exonerated, until it ended up on McCarthy's desk in February of 1950. McCarthy used the Lee List as the basis for his inflammatory speech on the Senate floor that incited the Lavender Scare. Senator Stiles Bridges then used the Lee List as an excuse to clean out the State Department. Bridges called the supposed homosexuals in Congress, quote, foul enemies of our republic, end quote, and charged that they were planted in the department as spies. Quote, they did not get there by osmosis or by accident. They got there because Russia wanted them there, end quote. Senator Miller Tidings of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee was tasked with investigating McCarthy's claims of infiltration. The Tidings Committee concluded that if there were any communists in the federal government, they didn't constitute a security risk, but McCarthyist hysteria had already taken hold of the country. In fact, the Tidings report didn't mention homosexuality at all, since Tidings didn't think it was relevant. This omission may have allowed the Lavender Scare to spread out of control. McCarthy and therefore the general public, began to conflate security risks with loyalty risks. That is to say, they began to conflate communism with gay people. Although the State Department frequently tried to rein this in, they were unsuccessful. The red and lavender scares became one intertwined mass of hysteria. Many people at the time saw the Soviet Union's use of women in high-ranking positions and their progressive family leave policy as evidence of the moral corruption of communism. A large part of what we think of as 1950s culture was a direct result of anti-communist hysteria at the time. Prior to the McCarthy era, Washington, D.C. had a thriving underground gay community, but people began to leave to search for jobs elsewhere, either out of fear or because they'd already been fired. The Lavender Scare demolished the gay community in D.C. D.C., being urban and therefore more tolerant than many small towns, enticed many young gay people to the city in the early 1930s. Drawn to the jobs created by the New Deal. By the late 1940s, the gay subculture in D.C. was pretty open and uncloseted, which scared older conservatives like McCarthy. Politicians thought that D.C. was becoming more gay because Soviet spies were planning an infiltration. What was actually happening was just that D.C. was becoming a major city. Historian Alan Berube described World War II as a, quote, nationwide coming out experience, end quote. Gay people were becoming more visible and more talked about. In 1948, Alfred Kinsey published his research on American sexuality. Sexuality became the talking point of the national consciousness. And his report scared people with its vastly higher numbers of gay people than anticipated. Later that same year, the Miller Sexual Psychopath Law was passed, making consensual adult sex with, quote, someone with the same sex organs, end quote, illegal. Heavy fines were imposed on adults participating in consensual gay sex. When Sumner Wells of President Franklin Roosevelt's cabinet was caught in a tryst with a black man, the resulting scandal was used for fodder by McCarthy. He pointed to it as proof that the Democrats were harboring sexual deviance. The public image of the State Department was changed. The general public seemed to think that everyone who worked there was gay. Much of the rhetoric of the Lavender Scare talks about how susceptible gay people were to blackmail by communists. The idea being that communists could blackmail state secrets out of gay people by threatening to out them. No one seemed to think about what would happen if the Soviets threatened to out someone if they weren't already afraid of the consequences from the US government. If nothing were to happen, and everyone were to shrug it off, if the Soviets outed someone, the blackmail threat would lose all steam. But instead, the U.S. government took to outing people preemptively. The State Department was targeted with rumors of homosexuality in its ranks because of its natural tendency toward diplomacy over war, which was seen as effeminate. The paradox of the Lavender Scare is that the gay people in the State Department were seen as too weak and girly to really govern or to use militant foreign affairs tactics, but were simultaneously dangerously powerful and with more control than they should have over U.S. politics. Echoing the Army's rationale during the war, the State Department dismissed gay candidates as a morale problem for the straight men and women already working there. In 1946, bills began being associated with the McCarran Rider, a stipulation that allowed heads of federal departments to dismiss any employee at any time for any reason. This would make it easier to get rid of suspected gay people without the hassle of severance pay or unlawful termination lawsuits. The discourse of national security tried to exploit fears that there was no way to tell apart gay people and straight people. This fear can be traced in part to the 1948 publication of the Kinsey Report. The government tried to use the numbers published by the Kinsey Report to prove that gay people were a security risk, but all they managed to prove was that there were probably more gay Americans than they thought. Starting in the late 1940s, heads of missions were all given memorandums on how to spot and dismiss gay members in their ranks. The State Department became utterly obsessed with rooting out and firing gay employees. In 1950, Republican Senator Kenneth Wherry alleged that Soviets were using a list of gay Americans, originally compiled by Hitler, to blackmail government employees for state secrets. He offered no proof. In March of 1950, the Blick revelation that Washington, D.C. housed 5,000 gay people and 3/4 of them worked in the federal government renewed public interest in the Lavender Scare. The Blick revelation was part of an investigation by Republican Senator Wherry into gay members in the federal government. Senator Wherry claimed that Russians had a secret list of all the gay people worldwide, which was acquired from Hitler. Using the list, they could blackmail gay employees of the federal government. He further claimed that these Soviet spies were enticing unsuspecting straight women into a life of lesbianism. Wherry's unsubstantiated claims represented phase two of the Lavender Scare. Where McCarthy had focused almost exclusively on the State Department, the next phase investigated the entire federal government. It also had more bipartisan support, with record numbers of Democrats joining committees designed to root out gay people in their ranks. In a sense, the Lavender Scare was always going to expand. From the outset, the Purefoy revelation created fear about where these dismissed gay employees had gone. To other federal agencies? The 1950 Senate hearings began as a byproduct of the Cold War and the Red Scare. Republicans, looking for a reason to attack a federal government long under Democratic control, used the Purefoy revelation to attack the Truman administration. In June of 1950, the Senate authorized the formation of a subcommittee under Senator Clyde Howe to investigate, quote, the employment of homosexuals and other sex perverts in government, end quote. The Howe Committee concluded that the military's anti-gay policies should be used as a model for the rest of the federal government. Senator Smith of the Howe Committee asked testifying psychologist Dr. Leonard Scheel, quote, there's no quick test like an x-ray that discloses these things, end quote. Senator Clyde Howe, elected in 1898 on a white supremacist platform, didn't want the job of investigating homosexuals and the government because he feared it would become a witch hunt, which would end up discrediting him and the Senate. Howe was extremely old-fashioned. He wasn't comfortable discussing homosexuality because of his views on its immorality. He tried to prevent Margaret Chase Smith, the only female member of the committee, from attending hearings because he didn't want to talk about such immoral things in front of a lady. In a private conversation to another committee member, Howe explained that he wanted to question witnesses further, but a lady was there, so he couldn't ask questions. One question he'd wanted to ask a doctor who was testifying was how the heck lesbianism worked. Apparently, the first time he'd heard of gay women was while this doctor was testifying. The man, charged with rooting out and charging gay people in the government, had no idea how homosexuality worked. Howe's lack of comfort and familiarity meant that his second-in-command, Francis Flanagan, pretty much ran the show. Francis Flanagan was poised to be McCarthy's second-in-command, but Flanagan was a Democrat, and McCarthy was pressured to choose a Republican, which is how Roy Cohn became McCarthy's second. The Howe Committee used testimony from military higher-ups to show that gay people were a problem. Without ever specifying what these military officers had actually testified, the final Howe report left out much of the testimony by medical experts and almost all other testimony that indicated that gay people were not security risks. In 1951, USA Confidential reporters, Latt and Mortimer, claimed that the infiltration of the federal government showcased a general breakdown in morals. The civil service, they claimed, had erased gender distinction, social selectivity, the color line, and the importance of citizenship. Latt and Mortimer further claimed that women working outside the home was shifting the gender dynamic and turning otherwise nice straight girls into prey for predatory lesbians. This article turned into the book Washington Confidential. It was a New York Times bestseller. In 1953, under pressure from the Hoey Committee, the Navy issued a memorandum that all gay people were to be immediately dismissed as security risks. In April of that year, President Dwight D. Eisenhower signed into law Executive Order 10450, which explicitly banned, quote, sexual perverts, end quote, from government employment. This expanded the Lavender Scare to all levels of federal employment. As civilian homosexuality became criminalized, the gay nightlife, which had flourished during the war, started to die out. But this restriction of gay outlets led to pent-up anger that began to burst through as civil disobedience. Gay people started going to gay bars again, intentionally getting arrested and committing other small violations of homophobic laws. DC police captain Blick publicly claimed that 5,000 gay people lived in DC and 3,750 of them worked for the federal government. When interviewed by Max Lerner of the New York Post about it, Blick changed his story twice about how he arrived at those numbers. In that same interview, Blick finally revealed that the numbers he'd given were pure fabrication. He also claimed to have a roster of registered homosexuals, but when the Senate subcommittee asked to see his rosters, he refused to give them over. Mostly because the roster didn't exist. Blick had been making it up. It was suggested at the time that the push to get civil servants out of politics was a deflection by those in power. Since the New Deal, politicians had been forced to tuck their tails and ask for help from experts in other fields, like economics and business. Politicians were elected and felt that they represented small-town America. But unelected civil servants were chosen via job selection for their qualifications. Historian Richard Hofstadter suggested that these more qualified and possibly smarter officials intimidated the existing Washington Boys Club, who deflected their insecurity by calling the New Dealers gay. The rising power of unelected officials chosen for their education fueled theories about secrets being passed that elected officials were not privy to. That is to say, the Red Scare and the Lavender Scare were both fear-based reactions to the rapid expansion of the federal government under the New Deal and during World War II. Worried about their image as Democrats, the Truman administration reached out to the Hoey Committee to ask how they could help. They didn't want to seem like the White House was harboring homosexuals. In the Hoey Committee's investigations, Admiral Roscoe Hillencoder provided testimony on Colonel Alfred Rettel. Rettel was the head of Austrian intelligence before World War I and, quote, one of the most famous double agents in the history of international espionage, end quote. The Russians sent a male prostitute to Rettel's hotel room, burst in on them together, and used that to blackmail him into working for them since the Austrians had a strict policy against homosexuality. Rettel's blackmail was on a different continent, during wartime, and in the military, so not really relevant to the Lavender Scare, but it was still used as an example of Soviet blackmail of gay civil servants. However, the Rettel case may not have even had anything to do with blackmail, since Rettel killed himself within hours of the Austrian government finding out about his sexuality. There's no evidence of what he was doing or if he was spying. Also, the story of the Russians planting a prostitute in his room and bursting in on him was pure fabrication. Hillencoder's testimony on Rettel was the only concrete evidence of gay people posing as security risk, and even that story has gaping holes. No one else could provide proof of gay people in the government being blackmailed or spilling state secrets. In fact, every single other witness to testify admitted under questioning that they had turned up no concrete evidence of anyone's sexuality being used to blackmail state secrets out of them. The military leaders who testified had long had a policy of excluding gay service members since World War II. But it was based on a psychological approach that claimed a lack of constitution for war and had nothing to do with being a security risk. CIA Director Hillencoder even noted that the stigma the government was creating was why homosexuality could be used by blackmailers. He said, quote, "Coercion and blackmail of homosexuals is particularly effective when homosexuality is universally condemned and actively attacked by the society in which the subject lives," end quote. Basically, if there's no stigma, then blackmail attempts by threatening to out someone lose their effectiveness. The best way to combat blackmail of gay people by the Soviets is to make sure there are no consequences by American society for the outing of gay people by the Soviets. Of course, Hillencoder took this to mean that the federal government should redouble their efforts to expel gay members from their midst, instead of taking the obvious meaning that they should destigmatize homosexuality. Hillencoder even admitted that the government sometimes used gay people as spies, especially when they had been approached by enemy agents, which the government could use to make it look like the spies had actually taken the enemy's offer. They admitted that the few cases they had of gay people being blackmailed had often worked out in favor of the US government and proven the loyalty of those gay people. None of this stopped the Lavender Scare. By the time the Hoey Committee got around to hearing from medical experts, most of the committee had already made up their minds about sexuality and loyalty, so very few bothered to attend. Most medical experts, interestingly, testified that gender and sexuality were fluid. They pointed out that physiologically, no one is 100% male or 100% female anyway. One psychiatrist pointed out that the negative view of homosexuality painted by some of the physicians, quote, "only sick people go to a doctor," end quote. Therefore, even the medical testimony isn't necessarily indicative of the population at large. The committee was confused by the conflicting testimony of psychology experts and security experts. The psychology experts pointed out that there was no diagnostic tool for sexuality, and the committee was frightened by their inability to identify security risks. Hoey's committee second-in-command, Francis Flanagan, claimed that, quote, "the medical experts knew less than anyone else," end quote. Mostly because framing homosexuality as a medical issue was uncomfortable and made punishing gay people for being gay feel wrong. Despite a complete lack of evidence, the Hoey Committee's final report said that gay individuals in government posed a security risk. The Hoey Report was used as the basis and justification for the exclusion of gay people from government work for years to come. The Hoey Committee's final report, "Employment of Homosexuals and Other Sex Perverts in Government," said that gay people, once hired in the federal government, will try to get other gay people hired or try to turn their straight co-workers gay. The Hoey Report stated, quote, "one homosexual can pollute a government office," end quote. In 1957, a Navy investigative report found that the Hoey Report was flawed, was only looking at incidental data, and clearly steeped in confirmation bias. The Crittenden Report, as the Navy investigation was called, was buried by the Pentagon and only publicized when it was discovered by attorneys in 1976. Although numerous investigative reports by all branches of the military and intelligence community found that the Hoey Report was flawed and that there was no evidence of Soviets targeting gay Americans for blackmail and espionage, the Hoey Report continued to be touted by those who wanted to use it to expel gay people from the federal government. The Hoey Committee investigation moved the Lavender Scare into nonpartisan territory. The publicity of the scandal drew support from both sides of the aisle. The presidential election of 1952, the first since the start of the Lavender Scare, made it a defining feature of the election. Republicans ran on the slogan, "Let's clean house." Richard Nixon ran against Democratic candidate Adlai Stevenson, who was unmarried and was a former State Department official. FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover circulated false information that Stevenson had been arrested in New York for homosexual behavior. This rumor was repeated by Stevenson's ex-wife, who was clearly still angry at her ex-husband for the divorce. The credibility of the rumors against Stevenson were so thin that newspapers refused to report them. McCarthy, however, went on record and on television saying that he had created a file on Stevenson as a suspected gay man. The rumor that Stevenson was gay spread so pervasively that many gay people decided to vote for him, and the election of 1952 became about being either for or against homosexuality. When Dwight D. Eisenhower won the presidency, he was the first Republican in the White House in 20 years, thanks in large part to the Republican stance on the Lavender Scare. Eisenhower immediately issued Executive Order 10450 that called for the automatic firing of any federal employee displaying, quote, any behavior which suggests the individual is not reliable or trustworthy, end quote. It specified, quote, any criminal, infamous, dishonest, immoral, or notoriously disgraceful conduct, habitual use of intoxicants to excess, drug addiction, or sexual perversion, end quote. This was the first time sexual perversion was specifically stated as a reason all on its own for dismissal, without mentioning loyalty. As fear and paranoia spread, employees at the State Department began informing on their coworkers, sending along letters with hints and suggestions. Most of these were simply hunches, but the State Department ended up firing many of the people implicated. When the U.S. threatened to pull funding from the United Nations unless it fired gay employees, the Secretary General agreed, but only on the condition that the U.S. provide concrete evidence of homosexual activity rather than rumors or inclinations. Although the U.S. had no authority to provide suitability information to international organizations or to recommend action for those organizations, it continued to do so until 1972. In the following years, the U.S. worked with law enforcement agencies around the world to install programs to weed out gay employees. Although few countries in the West had anti-gay laws as strict as America's, they feared a cooling of their close ties with the U.S. if they didn't play along. Scotland Yard in England hosted American agents who helped them set up a gay detection unit. Allied nations feared that the U.S. would no longer share intelligence with them unless they demonstrated an ability and an inclination to purge gay employees from their governments. When Executive Order 10450 expanded the Lavender Scare from the State Department to the whole of the federal government, it included departments with no access to national security information, which begs the question, was the Lavender Scare really about national security or about finding an excuse to perform homophobia? Why, for instance, was the National Gallery of Art in Washington having to perform checks on its employees? Executive Order 10450 also gave government agencies the power of summary dismissal of employees without having to justify a documentable reason. This meant that an employee could be dismissed just for being gay, for being a security risk, without having already endangered national security. When the White House released its numbers for 1952 of how many dismissals they had gotten, the press asked for specifics. Why were they fired? For being communist? For being gay? For being gossips? The press continued to blast the White House for equating serious crimes like treason with minor offenses like drunkenness. They also pointed out that in going through the actual data, almost no one had been fired for communism, which was supposedly the whole point of the purge, meaning the White House was engaged in actual misinformation. Journalist Anthony Lewis of the New York Daily News pointed out that the government's tactics created an environment that allowed blackmail to flourish. When a young woman was dismissed for having extramarital sex with men, the press pointed out that people were now being dismissed for being too gay and for being too straight. By 1955, the public was largely calling for evidence of effectiveness and reasoning for the continued persecution of gay federal employees. It was becoming harder and harder to make a connection between homosexuality and national security. A study noted that it was becoming difficult to fill government positions, and that the general public sympathized with those who had lost jobs to the Lavender Scare. By the end of the 1950s, the public consensus seemed to be that the Lavender Scare had gone too far. But in September of 1960, two U.S. intelligence agents, Vernon F. Mitchell and William H. Martin, defected to the Soviet Union. When it came out that Martin had experimented with his sexuality as a teen, the press ran with it, announcing further evidence of the link between homosexuality, communism, and treason. It's important to note that the HOE Committee and the general public still considered a single homosexual encounter to be evidence of homosexuality. Bisexuality was not well known, and the difference between sexual activity and sexual identity were not considered important at the time. This news story seemed to push the Lavender Scare back 10 years to 1950. The newspapers ran much the same stories about a secret ring of homosexuals and the government secretly conspiring with the Soviet Union. One journalist wrote, quote, "Obviously, there is no all-out and effective campaign against homosexuals in the federal service," end quote. The Lavender Scare became quieter, no longer publishing numbers of firings, but it continued. The tragedy of it, well, part of the tragedy of it, was that anyone dismissed from federal service was automatically assumed to be a communist or to be gay, which made them totally unemployable anywhere else, even if their firing had nothing to do with the Red or Lavender Scares. The government's control reached beyond just federal service. Other jobs, even unrelated to government, were off-limits. Almost any job that required a background check, such as any job working abroad, would flag people who had been fired from the federal government as security risks. The Lavender Scare caused a massive economic crisis for the gay community in the U.S. But the crisis wasn't just economic. One State Department official noted with regret that the Lavender Scare had killed a good number of Americans by so thoroughly ruining their lives that they took their own lives. The State Department began a campaign of misinformation to cover up the suicides they had caused, mentioning job strain and mental fitness in their statements to the press and to the families of their victims. There are examples of interrogating officials using coercive tactics, such as blackmail, to wrest confessions from suspects. One man was told by the State Department that they would tell his parents he was gay if he didn't confess to being gay right then. A few people, still figuring out their sexualities, were pushed along by the Lavender Scare. One man claimed that if people this bad could think that being gay was bad, it was probably good. And he stopped hiding that part of himself. Unlike the Red Scare, the Lavender Scare didn't publish the names of people it fired. That meant that homosexuality was a lurking specter without a face or humanity for much of the Lavender Scare. The general public found it much easier to swallow because there weren't real people being affected by it within the public view. It's hard to calculate exactly how many people lost their jobs to the Lavender Scare, because many people were recorded as having voluntarily resigned as a result of questioning. By the mid-1960s, the State Department had fired about 1,000 people for homosexuality, though that number's not exact. Because the State Department averaged about 1/5 of the total firings across government agencies, it can be assumed that about 5,000 people were fired or forced to resign because of their sexuality during the Lavender Scare. It's hard to calculate how many people were affected by the Lavender Scare because many resigned preemptively when the questioning started, and many more opted not to apply for government jobs in the first place out of fear. Many ex-service members who had been given blue or undesirable discharges during World War II thought that their plight was over, only to be confronted with the Lavender Scare. Interestingly, the widespread persecution of gay people during the Lavender Scare instigated the nationalization of the gay rights movement. Because they were ostracized by straight people everywhere, gay people began to congregate more and to form relationships amongst themselves. Not only sexual and romantic relationships, but relationships of friendship and found family as well. Gay clubs like the Mattachine Society sprung up in response to the Lavender Scare. Although the society's staunch anti-political rules eventually led to its dissolution. When government astronomer Frank Kameny was charged with homosexuality and fired, he sued the federal government. Not on the basis that he was not gay, but on the constitutionality of the ban on gay people in federal government. This effectively reframed the issue of one not of national security, but of civil rights. Frank Kameny started up the Mattachine Society of Washington, where gay members could discuss issues of homosexuality. But because of the fear of infiltration by undercover agents, pseudonyms were used by all the members. The Mattachine Society petitioned Congress for the right to defend their license before the House District Committee, and was granted their request. This would be the first congressional testimony by an openly gay person in U.S. history. Despite listening to Kameny's testimony, Congress refused to overturn the anti-gay rules in place in federal government. Republicans in Congress tried to argue the security risk angle, but when an attorney advised the MSW that groups only had to be licensed if they made more than $1,500 annually in profit, the Mattachine Society stopped fighting Congress and let their license be revoked. Since their profit that year had only been $200, the Mattachine Society could operate unlicensed. Despite the fact that they didn't win their case, the public hearings helped to recenter the Lavender Scare around civil rights instead of national security. In 1947, Bruce Scott was arrested for suspected homosexuality, although he had successfully avoided entrapment by an undercover officer. When this arrest showed up on a background check for federal employment in 1956, Scott was fired. For the next few years, he struggled to find work in his field as an astronomer. Eventually, with nowhere else to turn, Scott requested legal help from Frank Kameny and the Mattachine Society of Washington. After being denied federal employment for years, Scott filed suit in April of 1963 and was represented by the American Civil Liberties Union, or ACLU. In 1963, Judge Hart of the U.S. District Court ruled against Scott. Scott appealed the decision. Another case central to the Lavender Scare, in 1952, Edward Kelly sat on a park bench and struck up a conversation with Frank Manthos. After talking for a bit, Kelly invited Manthos back to his apartment for a drink. Manthos then revealed himself to be an undercover police officer and arrested Kelly for homosexuality. He was convicted in a DC court. Kelly appealed his conviction. The U.S. Court of Appeals found that Manthos didn't have enough evidence and they overturned Kelly's conviction. This set a new precedent. If there was only one witness to alleged sodomy, the court needed some circumstantial evidence to back it up. They couldn't rule based on two people arguing different sides of a story. As a result of the Kelly appeal, conviction rates for homosexuality plummeted. Prosecutors, angry at the Kelly appeal, encouraged police officers to get offenders to touch them rather than just proposition them verbally, so that gay defendants could be charged with assault, not just solicitation. When one police officer arrested a man for brushing up against him after the plainclothes officer had flirted with the man, the U.S. Court of Appeals ruled that the officer had initiated the contact and brushing up against someone did not constitute assault. So prosecutors' entrapment plan also had to be scrapped. For most of the late 1940s and 50s, the Lavender Scare had rested on the existing idea that homosexuality was a mental illness. At that time, the DSM-1, Psychology's Diagnostic and Statistical Manual, listed both homosexuality and communism as mental illnesses, making it easier for the government to conflate the two. It was thought that someone with one of these mental illnesses had a predisposition for the other. But that began to change near the middle of the decade. After administering a series of psychological tests to 30 gay and 30 straight participants, psychologist Dr. Evelyn Hooker passed the results along to a number of psychologists to analyze in a blind study, where they didn't know which test belonged to which participant. The study concluded that all the men were mentally fit. This meant that there was no inherent link between sexuality and mental health. In 1956, Dr. Hooker presented her findings to the American Psychological Association in Chicago. Dr. Hooker's study paved the way for people to do psychological studies on sexuality, a previously taboo idea. As the general opinion of the public started to catch up with the changing opinion of the psychology community, public support for the Lavender Scare began to wane. From the end of the 1950s into the 1960s, courts started overturning some wartime and Cold War-era gay convictions. But in the mid-1960s, the movement turned toward the laws themselves and their lack of constitutionality. In 1960, the Washington Post reported on an absurd story where three plainclothes officers had attacked each other in Lafayette Park in Washington, D.C., all trying to arrest each other for homosexual behavior. As the Post pointed out, this incident couldn't have happened if the officers had declared themselves, which was proof that the D.C. Metropolitan Police were engaging in entrapment. These slow revelations and the slowly changing zeitgeist mirrored the expansion of the infant gay rights movement in the U.S. at the time. Because the gay rights movement was so new, part of the issue was getting gay people to be seen as a minority in order to get legal protections as a minority. A large part of the reason that the Lavender Scare had even happened was because the employment discrimination wasn't illegal since gay people weren't a protected class. In 1964, the ACLU called on the government to, quote, end its policy of rejection of all homosexuals on that ground alone, end quote. It noted that while homosexuality might be a relevant factor in some jobs, it didn't work as a blanket policy. An echo of the Red Scare that defined it, the Lavender Scare used communism to further their cause. When headlines touting that Cuba had put gay citizens in labor camps went public in the mid-1960s, the Mattachine Society of Washington picketed in front of the White House, comparing anti-gay policies of the U.S. to those of communist countries like Cuba and Russia. In June of 1965, the U.S. Court of Appeals ruled in favor of Bruce Scott. The court stated that unspecified homosexual behavior was not grounds for dismissal, and that burden of proof rested on the prosecution to show that homosexuality had led to other immoral behavior or treason. The Scott case meant that moving forward, those accused of being security risks were entitled to legal discovery by prosecution. This meant that the federal government had to actually acquire evidence of homosexuality leading to immorality instead of just relying on rumor or risk. This also meant that the government had to explain its anti-gay policy. An attempt to do so was made on September 8, 1965, when five members of the MSW met with the Civil Service Commission. The CSC claimed that this new idea that homosexuality was an identity was incorrect, therefore the policy was not discriminatory. Because homosexuality was a choice and an action, the policy was about morality. This shift from security to morality on the part of the federal government reflected the recent openness and nationalization of the gay community. No longer could the government claim potential blackmail as an issue because many of the people they were firing had already outed themselves. Except the State Department. The State Department continued to claim security risks. In 1966, the case of Benning Wentworth went before the Supreme Court. The difference in Wentworth's case was he requested his trial be open to the public, and crucially, Wentworth did press interviews. If he was open about his sexuality, how could it be used to blackmail him? Wentworth's very openness began to erode the State Department's already thin reasoning for the Lavender Scare. Slowly, federal agencies stopped firing gay employees if they were doing good work. The policies of the Lavender Scare were still in place, but they were sporadically enforced. Then, in 1969, Clifford Norton a gay man who had been fired from NASA in 1963, was defended in the Supreme Court by the ACLU. He acknowledged in court that he was gay, and the Supreme Court asked the Civil Service Commission to prove, beyond a reasonable doubt, that Norton's homosexuality was a security or morality risk. When the CSC couldn't provide a good rationale, the court ruled in favor of Norton on July 1st, 1969. The Supreme Court had ruled that homosexuality was not, in itself, grounds for dismissal from federal service. The Norton decision became precedent. Prosecution had to show a reasonable and clear connection between an employee's off-duty activities and their ability to do their jobs. Later that same year, on October 6th, 1969, the National Institute of Mental Health declared that homosexuality was not a mental illness. By the late 1960s, even the Civil Service Commission had to admit that it was acting against the general zeitgeist. The commission said in a public statement, quote, "attitudes toward what consenting adults do in private are changing," end quote. Frank Kameny and Barbara Giddings of the Mattachine Society of Washington ran a table at the 1970 APA conference called "Gay, Proud, and Healthy, the Homosexual Community Speaks," about how homosexuality wasn't a mental illness. The next year, in 1971, Kameny and Giddings were invited back to the APA conference for a panel called "Psychiatry, Friend or Foe to Homosexuals? A Dialogue." Giddings read off statements sent in by gay psychiatrists to show that there were people who were both. As a result of that panel, a group was formed within the APA for gay psychiatrists, and in 1973, the APA Board of Trustees voted to remove homosexuality from the list of mental disorders. The APA action in 1973 had a huge impact on the view of homosexuality. Legally, it no longer made sense to exclude this group because they weren't considered mentally ill. That same year, a federal court in California forced the Civil Service Commission to end its exclusion of gay people. In his decision, Judge Alfonso Zirpoli said that, quote, "the notion that it could be an appropriate function of federal bureaucracy to enforce the majority's conventional moral code of conduct in the private lives of its employees is at war with elementary concepts of liberty, privacy, and diversity," end quote. In December 1973, the Civil Service Commission capitulated, issuing a bulletin that declared that homosexuality on its own could no longer be considered grounds for dismissal. It was the final nail in the coffin of the Lavender Scare. The scare tried to continue a little longer, but while it continued investigating, the government had no legal grounds to fire gay people anymore, and even the investigations petered out eventually. Communism and homosexuality were linked because both groups were making waves and telling American society that it needed to change. At a time that was extremely nationalistic, criticizing the power structure of the country was not approved of. The Lavender Scare was about more than just how many people were fired. It was about how many people were afraid for their livelihoods and reputations. It was about how many people lived in constant fear of being outed. It was about the public backlash to the very existence of gay people. Although the Lavender Scare ended in most federal agencies in 1975, it continued in some of them, like the military and the NSA. In 1995, President Bill Clinton signed an executive order banning discrimination based on sexual orientation in the granting of security clearances. And in 1998, discrimination based on sexual orientation in government employment was banned. Back in 1957, World War II veteran and U.S. Army Map Service astronomer Frank Kameny was fired for being gay. On June 29, 2009, Kameny was presented with a personal apology on behalf of the United States government. And on January 9, 2017, Secretary of State John Kerry issued a formal apology to the LGBTQIA+ community for the Lavender Scare. In his statement, Kerry said, quote, "In the past, as far back as the 1940s, but continuing for decades, the Department of State was among many public and private employers that discriminated against employees and job applicants on the basis of perceived sexual orientation. forcing some employees to resign or refusing to hire certain applicants in the first place. These actions were wrong then, just as they would be wrong today. End quote. The Lavender Scare was a dark period in American history, marked by mistrust and backstabbing, a period of misplaced paranoia and fear of the unknown. In an ironic but predictable turn of events, it was the heavily oppressive atmosphere cultivated by the Lavender Scare that fast-tracked the nationalization of the gay rights movement in the 1960s and 70s. The Lavender Scare coalesced gay people from all over the country into a recognizable community by giving them a common and very visible enemy in the form of the federal government. The Lavender Scare was the spark that created the organized, nationalized gay rights movement in the U.S. But because the Lavender Scare sort of lost steam before it decisively ended, it's hard to call it a rallying cry for gay rights. The Norton decision that effectively ended the Lavender Scare was overshadowed by the Stonewall Riot that took place that same week in June of 1969. Although the Lavender Scare wasn't the centrifugal force of the gay rights movement, it helped create the nationalized gay community, the first step in organizing toward a gay rights movement. Thank you so much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, be sure to give it a thumbs up and tell me what you liked about it in the comment section below. Did you learn something new? Had you heard of the Lavender Scare before? If you didn't enjoy this video, give it a thumbs down and tell me what I can do to improve. If you're interested in more nerdy history content, be sure to subscribe and ring the bell to get notified about new videos, which I post on some Fridays. Thank you so much for watching, and remember, those who don't learn from the past are doomed to repeat it. So don't doom yourself. I'll see you next time. Bye.